Hello, happy International Women's Day. My name is Daphna and I head up nonprofit and corporate partnerships here at LuminAID. We're really excited to be going live today with a special guest from our partner ShelterBox, which is an international disaster relief aid nonprofit. We've been working with ShelterBox since 2013. We supply them with solar lanterns and solar phone chargers that they use as part of their relief aid operations. And our guest today is YiShun Lai, who's a ShelterBox Response Team member. And she has been volunteering with ShelterBox for the past 10 years, both as a member of the response team as well as an ambassador, which means that she raises funds for ShelterBox. And so we're really happy to have her with us because she just returned from a deployment in the Philippines, where she was conducting monitoring and evaluation as part of ShelterBox's response there. YiShun, thank you so much for joining us.
Daphna, it is such a pleasure to be here with you today on International Women's Day.
Yes, we're really excited to have you here. And it's really great to be doing this on International Women's Day because ShelterBox is also launching a campaign this month called the She Campaign. And the focus of that campaign is how disaster relief disproportionately impacts women because they are more vulnerable as a marginalized population, but also the potential that they have in community rebuilding and recovery. And so I would actually love it if you could give us a little bit of background, YiShun, on ShelterBox's work and also on the She campaign's mission.
Absolutely. Since 2000, ShelterBox has been providing critical aid to folks who have lived through both natural and natural disasters and conflict zones. And essentially, we do that in the form of the classic shelter box, which is a big green tote that is filled with everything you might think your family would need if your home had come down an earthquake or had been washed away in a flood. So that aid typically consists of a large family tent that's mm-hmm. really sturdy, things like pots and pans, water purification, solar lights, clearly. So anything that your family would need to make your way through the critical months after the disaster, we try to provide for you. In recent years, we've also been able to provide even more flexible aid in the format of what we call shelter kits, which is a kit that comprises two tarpaulins that are really heavy duty, as well as tools like shovels and hammers and saws, as well as some fixings that you may be able to use to help the tarpaulins to help you to build your home up. The agency, as I said, has been around for nearly 20 years. We started in the year 2000, and we've been pleased to help over a million families, wow. a million people since then. So we've been really pleased to be able to do that and to have you be part of the journey.
Yeah, and we've been really excited to be part of that process along the years. It's given us a lot of insight, too, into how to develop our technology to best serve the needs of families who are impacted by disasters. And so the mm-hmm. partnership that we have with the ShelterBox team has been really great. Can you tell us?
Yeah, I think that adaptation. Sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, I think that adaptation that you're speaking of has been a really critical part of our evolution as well. As we help more and more families and we go on to visit different countries where they may have individual needs that are specific to their region, we learn more and more. So that consistent evolution is a part of what we do.
Definitely. Yeah. Can you tell us a little bit more about the deployment that you just did in the Philippines, especially what you were doing there and how that fits into ShelterBox's work?
Yeah, this is my 13th deployment for ShelterBox, wow. and it actually is a really special one for me. It's my second time in the Philippines. The Filipinos have this extraordinary spirit called Bayanihan, which loosely means community helping each other, right? So it's always wonderful to visit a country that lives by that edict. And frankly, everywhere we go, every country has some format of that. This time around, it was unusual also because we were on a hybrid deployment mm-hmm. that employed both our skill set in terms of having to distribute aid and make sure that the families got what they needed, working with local communities and local government units and so on and so forth. But also we did what's called monitoring and evaluation, which is something that I believe not many aid agencies do.
Yeah, it's difficult.
We spend some time with the family, probably up to about half an hour or about an hour with each family, speaking to them about the aid that we provided to ensure that it was actually the best that we could do for them, and to make sure that the aid is actually working for them in the ways that work best for them.
Yeah.
Right. We also got to work with ShelterBox's first ever remote operations hub, which was in the Philippines. We have deployed to the Philippines more than any other country in our 18-year history. So for us to be able to work with locals who are based in the Philippines all the time to be able to provide that aid, made our operations so much more fluid. And not for nothing, but it is a woman-led office.
That's so awesome.
The two women who work there, Marlu and Rose, are just extraordinary go-getters, and to have them on deck to be able to speak to families for us was amazing.
That's great. And so when you did your monitoring and evaluation, you mentioned, I think, when we spoke prior to the call, that one of the things you were looking at is how the relief aid supplies that you distributed were being used after the immediate distribution, and also how they were holding up. Do you have any stories of how people were using their LuminAID lights after the immediate distribution that occurred in the Philippines?
Yeah, absolutely. Solar lights, we found, have been one of those tools that have allowed us to really see how a community recovers.
Yeah.
Right? Most of the time, we think of things like security in terms of allowing families to, say, move from place to place when electricity is out, right?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of these families have, for instance, comfort rooms or restrooms that exist outside of their home. So when they're navigating roads that are covered with debris, obviously it's so much easier for them to be able to get outside. But one thing that we learned, and actually I saw this in Dominica as well when mm-hmm. I was there doing M&E deployment last year, was that the solar lights allow communities to gather together much more quickly. They are able to do things like resuming community dinners, right? Or they're able to do things like, in the case of some community members in Dominica, they were actually able to get together and do each other's hair.
That's awesome.
It's not something we ever foresaw happening, right? So for us, I think it's a lot of times when it comes to things like solar lights, there is a sense of discovery, you know, about these tools that we didn't notice or that we didn't immediately think of that are providing aid for, right? Another thing that we saw happening now outside of solar lights is the tools that we provide.
Uh-huh.
When I was in Malawi, we heard that a lot of families were having to walk to Zimbabwe, which is the next country over, FYI, Mozambique. It's the other direction. But still, it's a 20-kilometer walk,
yeah.
Right? But the thing is that if they showed up with their own tools, they were able to actually get work more quickly because the farmers who they were working for didn't have to then provide tools for them. So it's things like that it really brings out the value of monitoring and evaluation. The kit seems to be holding up really well, and we're really happy with that.
That's great. In particular, because this is International Women's Day, can you tell us a little bit more about why women are a vulnerable population that ShelterBox seeks to serve after disasters?
Yeah, absolutely. The easiest answer is, and probably the most all-encompassing answer across the board, is that women already start out at a disadvantage. So in every situation across the board, in every disaster, and in every natural in every man-made conflict, essentially what happens is women are at a greater risk for violence.
Yeah.
Whatever inequality or inequity they started out with is manifested, you know, multiple fold, right? So we end up in a situation where these women who were vulnerable before, maybe because they were single parents, or maybe because they didn't have schooling, or in the case of Indonesian tsunami, because they were never taught how to swim or how to climb trees, they're in a situation to be even more vulnerable than before. In other cases, you see things like just basic where they are when the disaster strikes, right? Women are often at home with their children. They're not out in the fields working. So when things like earthquakes happen or floods happen, they're trapped. They can't have any place to go. And of course, you know, they always have the added burden of looking after their children. So that's one thing that we look at on a regular basis.
Yeah. And I think it's really valuable that ShelterBox is seeking out vulnerable and marginalized groups and making sure that the aid they're delivering is getting to them. And I think that's important as part of our approach.
Yeah, it is. I think for the purposes of this discussion too, that it's critical to note that although these women are one of the most vulnerable groups, they also play a critical role in the community rebounding.
Yeah.
Right? And a lot of that happens because women are naturally placed to be leaders in the community. The activities that they undertake, like getting the kids to school or gathering water or making sure that the community has enough food to eat, all of these natural roles provide them opportunities to be natural leaders. So that's one of the most heartwarming things
yeah.
to see. Is these women stepping into roles of leadership that they may not have ever had the opportunity to pursue in the first place.
Are there any women that you've met as part of your ShelterBox relief deployments that you'd like to share any stories about?
I'm really excited you asked me that question. I actually was on WhatsApp with two of the women this morning.
Wow, that's awesome.
Talking to them about International Women's Day and congratulating them on the work they've done in their community. One is my friend Sarita, who lives in the in Dominica with her husband, Avondale. They have three kids. And, you know, the two of them really stepped up in their community when Maria came through. Avondale did not take care of his own yard. There was a gigantic palm tree lying across their kitchen, and he refused to do anything about it until he actually went and helped his community. And in the meantime, Sarita, stepping over this palm tree on a regular basis to gather food and supplies, was actually cooking for the entire community.
Wow.
She was a kindergarten teacher before Maria happened. She's now gone back to being a kindergarten teacher. You can't take the community out of these people. It's just the way they're built. I also would love to tell you about Beatrice, who is a friend of mine who lives in Malawi. I met her responding to the Malawi floods and then later reconnected with her when we went back for monitoring and evaluation. Beatrice is a unicorn among women. She was studying to be a computer scientist and then later on decided she wanted to be a geriatric nurse. Mm-hmm. Is now an HIV assistant in Malawi. So she's working really hard. She's moved out of her father's home and has built her own home herself. So she's doing really well. And then finally, I want to tell you about Ate Chati, who I met this last time around in the Philippines. She was part of the local government unit. And it wasn't until week 5 that we found out that she had been a recipient of ShelterBox aid.
Wow. So you had been working with her to deliver aid to the community. And she also had been receiving aid for her own family.
Yeah, that's she awesome. Didn't say a word. She did not say a word. And, you know, this is the thing. When we talk about resilience, I'm getting goosebumps. Excuse me. I may get a little weepy. Pardon me about it. But, you know, the reality is that so many of these women, they step up because this is what they need to do in that time of need. You know, they say that your brain doesn't hand you things to work on until it's ready or it thinks you're ready holistically to handle it, right? But these women are ready.
Yeah.
You know, they've been preparing for this kind of leadership for all their lives. They didn't even know it. But, you know, when a woman like Chati or like Jinky, who I met when I deployed to the Philippines for high-end, steps up and she's been following you around for days and pointing out neighbors that need help, and then you find out that their family is in need of aid too, that's real strength.
Yeah.
And it's real inspiration, you know?
So how can people who want to support ShelterBox's She campaign get involved?
Oh, that's, of course, my favorite question on the planet. ShelterBox, like many other disaster relief agencies, we get donated to when terrible things happen, right? I mean, the disaster strikes, everybody who's not affected in that community suddenly wants to help in some way, shape, or form. So for us, consistently keeping ShelterBox and agencies like ours on the radar screen so that we know that we're ready to be deployed to deploy our aid and we're ready to deploy volunteers when the time strikes is probably the best way you can do it, right? So year-round giving is kind of one of those things that we're always looking at. The other thing, obviously, is to be an ambassador for us, raise money, spread the word. If you're involved in Rotary and your Rotary Club doesn't know about us, please, please, please let us know. We were founded by a Rotarian, so we're always making sure that Rotarians know about us. But yeah, in general, just be aware that someone out there is having the worst week of their lives, no matter what time of year it is, right? There are always disasters that don't hit the headlines. So that's what we excel at responding to, and we want to keep on doing that. So please visit our website, shelterbox.org, and just make sure that that you are keeping tabs on what we're doing.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And I think that for us as well, you know, one thing that we definitely have seen is that when it comes to disaster relief, people being involved, getting prepared, giving before the disaster even happens, really can just make things that much faster in that emergency situation once there is a need to deploy. And so that's one reason that, you know, ShelterBox as a customer of ours pre-positions our lights in the shelter boxes so that they need to be raising those funds year round in order to have product ready to deploy right away when disaster hits, because you can't always predict. And so I think the message of regular giving and being involved before a disaster strikes as a donor to really help organizations prepare is important.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. In 2010, we deployed to Haiti for the Haitian earthquake, obviously, and we were in a situation where our shelves were nearly stripped bare, and we never ever want to be in that situation again, right? Because large scale disasters are definitely out there, and they are coming as climate change happens, and we're consistently looking at more and more disasters. We want to be ready for that kind of thing, so we're depending on you to help us to do that.
Definitely. So we encourage anyone who's watching, if you want to donate to ShelterBox, you can go to shelterbox.org/she. for the International Women's Day campaign. And then also check out the links in the comments for ways to get involved, to donate. And if you want to learn more about LuminAID, you can head to luminaid.com as well, learn about our technology and some of the other things we do as well. Before we wrap up, I just want to thank you so much for joining us and for sharing some of these stories. If you have more comments or questions for YiShun or for LuminAID, please definitely get into the comments. There will be members of both teams responding, and we'll definitely be featuring some more really great stories from ShelterBox response team members over the coming months.
Thank you so much for having me, Daphne. Have a great day.
You too. Thank you.